In previous videos on the Fermi Paradox, we discussed a number of solutions to the question of why life seems so rare in the universe. One of the more popular scenarios is called the rare Earth option. But rather than just doing a video discussing that in more detail than we already have, we'll use it as a segue into a separate series. We're going to look at all the weird planets, and even non-planets, where life might just conceivably get a foothold. And while we'll still be raising all the problems and hurdles life would have existing in these places, we will be looking at it from a more optimistic viewpoint. To commemorate the flyby of Pluto taking place at the time I'm recording this, we are going to start off by looking at how life might be able to live on a place like Pluto, a relatively small planet far from a star's warming light. So, we will be looking at Pluto and worlds like Pluto in this first installment. We will look at how they might conceivably host life, and also how such worlds might be colonized to be homes to humans or other technological species. In future installments, we will be looking at everything from worlds around red dwarf stars or on moons around gas giants, or even in gas giants, both those near stars or rogue worlds out in the interstellar void. We'll look at how life might live in a comet or an asteroid. We'll try to cover all the reasonable options, and even some of the crazier ones. Hit the subscribe button if you want to be alerted when those new episodes come out. So if you've seen previous videos, you'll probably notice I've started adding in some animations. We've got two other new features as well. First, we'll be trying to keep these videos shorter.
Yeah!
And second, I'll be experimenting with adding in subtitles.
Yeah!
I know I'm a bit hard to follow sometimes, and remind people of some fictional characters. If you're curious, it is a speech impediment, not an accent. Hopefully with the subtitles, I'll be easier for some of you to follow. Assuming it works, of course. So let's get started. I want to emphasize that this is a very hypothetical video. Personally, I doubt we'd find life on Pluto, even very simple organisms. But we can't rule it out completely. It isn't just that such life might run on weird chemistry compared to our own. There could be habitable pockets where Earth-like life could live. What about that really alien life, though? Pluto and worlds like it are basically oversized comets. Most of the material is stuff that would melt or evaporate if it were on Earth. Ice, ammonia, methane, carbon dioxide, and even oxygen and nitrogen are frozen solid there. But hydrogen and helium are not. Hydrogen doesn't freeze till it gets even colder than Pluto gets, so worlds like it, even ones in the interstellar void, could easily have liquid hydrogen in abundance. When we're talking about life, the key thing is a power source. Hydrogen burns, so you could conceivably have an organism on the supercore worlds that drank liquid hydrogen and frozen oxygen and used that as a fuel or food. Pretty out there, but probably not impossible. But what about Earth-like life? Is that at all possible? Throughout this series, we'll mention over and over that the key thing life needs is a fuel. It needs a power source. But to be at all Earth-like, it needs pressure and temperature, too. If you're far from a sun, your options are limited. But we've got two big ones. First, a lot of worlds have pockets of radioactive materials. Those decay with time, but are also a lot more plentiful for that reason when a world is younger. Uranium, potassium, and other substances will give off some warmth just as they do for Earth. When planets form, matter falls down on them and impacts, so they tend to be very hot from absorbing all that, and they may have a steady flow of meteor impacts adding some heat over with time. Between radioactive materials and impacts, a planet may be warm and retain warm pockets deep beneath its surface. There's also tidal heating. If a planet has a moon, and Pluto does, actually it has several, then the constant distortions of gravity yanking on the world can keep it quite warm. This is what keeps Jupiter's moon Io a ball of molten lava. So while surface life, walking around and breathing air, probably isn't in the cards with anything like normal Earth life, there could be deep and massive oceans on these planets. Indeed, we're pretty sure Pluto does have underground oceans, and that even its largest moon, Charon, might have some. Where you've got liquid water being churned out with minerals dissolved in it, you have the possibility for life. We still don't know what started life here on Earth, or if our main candidates of underwater thermal vents, so-called black smokers, are the only way for it to emerge, if that's what started things off here in the first place. But regardless of how it gets started, once in place, life could be able to thrive in any ocean so long as there's some power source stirring up the water. Throughout this series, we'll see that there's a lot of candidates for that which wouldn't even qualify as a dwarf planet like Pluto, let alone an Earth-sized planet. Now, complex life, especially intelligent tool users, is a different story. Ocean life obviously can't support fire or many of the other technological precursors like metallurgy, pottery, glassblowing, or even basic chemistry. It's kind of hard to mix solutions in water. There's also the matter of thriving being somewhat relative. We have a long and dense food chain because everything runs on abundant sunlight. If you're familiar with life down in caves or the deep oceans, you know that those are all optimized to run on very little energy, and they still get most of that from debris flowing down from where there is sunlight. Some life-bearing Pluto equivalent could easily have less than 1% of all biomass, and still all spread out. And it's rather hard to develop a civilization when you all spread out. All hunter-gatherers need around 1 square mile per person to live, far more in tundra or desert climates. And that limited them a lot on developing. If you're 100 or 1,000 times more spread out to gather food, you'd have some serious roadblocks to forming civilizations. So, we can't rule it out, but where simple life, and even animal life, are reasonable expectations off worlds like Pluto, that expectation would have to be far smaller, where anything really complex like us is concerned. The next thing to consider is what do we mean by worlds like Pluto? Pluto's small, smaller than our own moon even. It's cold. It has a large moon that isn't just tidally locked to it, but to which is tidally locked to as well. Which of these factors apply to what we've been talking about here? While a bigger planet, say Earth, transported out there and left for, a billion years to orbit around it, would behave a lot differently. It will have a thicker atmosphere. Pluto has one, but barely worth mentioning, just like the moon has one. Earth's atmosphere contains virtually no hydrogen, except where it's locked up in molecules like water or methane, because molecular hydrogen doesn't stick around on warm planets. But it's the most common substance in the universe, so an Earth-mass planet could easily have an ocean and atmospheres made of molecular hydrogen. It would probably be warmer, too, since heat loss in a vacuum is all about surface area. More surface, more heat loss. Pluto might only have about 0.2% of Earth's mass, but it has nearly 3% of its surface area, a 15-to-1 higher ratio. So when it comes to heat derived from radioactive decays, bigger planets will stay warmer. If we're pondering a low-temperature life form that uses liquid or gaseous hydrogen instead of air or water the way we do, you could have life swimming around in surface oceans of Earth-mass worlds that weren't even near a star. As to Pluto-like world in mass and composition near a star, it would probably evaporate. Pluto is more like a giant comet than a planet or an asteroid. Another reason it has a relatively large surface area, it just isn't very dense. But a less massive world than Earth, even one less massive than Mars, could actually retain a thick atmosphere. There is a misconception from the Moon and Mars that gravity is a key there, which it mostly is, but there's a lot more leeway on it than people tend to think. We'll discuss that in future videos on life for more or less massive planets. Last thing, what about colonizing a place like Pluto? Can we, with the kind of technology we have now, or can reasonably predict we'll get, live on a place like Pluto? The answer is basically a straight yes. Even without some power source like fusion or old-school nuclear fission, we can power ourselves out there. Burning hydrogen oxygen, or methane oxygen, specifically on Pluto, isn't very viable because there's not a lot of oxygen around there except as water, but there is some, and other Pluto-like worlds might have more. Plus, not everything needs oxygen to burn. For instance, the spacecraft flying by Pluto right now has hydrazine thrusters, and that's a mix of nitrogen and hydrogen, both abundant on Pluto, and it doesn't need oxygen to create thrust and heat. So, chemical power isn't totally ruled out, even for Pluto, let alone other parallel worlds. Nor is solar power, The sunlight out there is barely a thousandth of what it is here in intensity, but 1 watt per square meter is still nothing to shrug at. That's actually brighter than the night under a full moon. A 10-watt LED light in a room in your house is delivering light comparable to what you get from the sun out there, so it isn't dark. What's more, you've got options like solar mirrors. The idea of creating planet-sized mirrors to reflect more sunlight onto a world sounds very crazy, but when you're talking about mirrors that only need to be as thick as paper, or even thinner, manufacturing ones the size of whole planets can be done with less mass than you'd have even a very small moon no bigger than a modest mountain on Earth. If you've seen my original YouTube video, Megastructures, then you know doing something like that is actually very modest compared to some of the projects we envision getting ourselves up to in the future. So, even if we never figure out fusion, these freezing cold worlds aren't necessarily off our radar to put habitations on. Though obviously that would be ideal, followed by good old fission power with something like uranium or thorium. Gravity isn't necessarily an issue either. It's very low on Pluto, about 7% of Earth normal, compared to 16% on the Moon. But as also mentioned in that Megastructures video, centrifugal or spin gravity isn't limited just to use in zero or microgravity environment. Instead of using a spinning cylinder, you just slope the floors to combine natural gravity with spin, just like how water in your washing machine will form a sloped surface when spinning as gravity and centrifugal forces add their power together. You can do that on a low gravity world to create an effective decent gravity. You don't need to build sturdy surface domes either. You dig in a few hundred feet deep on Pluto and the pressure of the ice over you will keep pockets of air at normal Earth pressures. This would also protect you from cosmic rays and micrometeors in the absence of an atmosphere or magnetosphere. You'd have to artificially light and heat the place so you could grow food, but we can do pretty dense and efficient hydroponics when we need to. So, in summary, can we colonize a place like Pluto? Yeah. Can life evolve there naturally? Quite possibly, though not likely anything we could chat with. I hope you've enjoyed this first video on planetary habitability. Don't forget to hit the like button if you have, and subscribe if you want to be alerted to future ones. Feel free to leave a comment below, I read them all and I try to reply to questions. And check out my other vids. Have a great day and thanks for watching.